guys, all in all, we were missing one small concept here. Let's say there were 100 people who were of that assistant manager rank whom we thought that we are allotting 1000 options per employee. Now you can't expect everyone to complete 3 years employment. Not possible. There could be some people who have got some better offers or due to some other reason, he's exiting the company within this 3 years continuous employment. Then definitely he is not entitled to the options at all. So whenever we are talking about such type of employees, this is one type of employees whom we'll call it as lapse of option. We'll call them by the word lapse of option. So when can an options lapse? First thing, when a person is leaving the organization within the period of vesting. This is one case where the options can lapse. And the second condition for the lapse is, let's say he has continued for 3 years. Let's say the options were vested to him on 31st March 2019. But if he did not pay the amount within this 1 year period, after 1 year, even if he comes to the payment, the options cannot be exercised because there's one more lapse towards the end. So there are two lapses when we talk about. The first lapse, if the vesting condition is not satisfied, or second one, if the vested options are not exercised, until the end of exercise period. So when there is a lapse of option, to that extent of the options, I am not incurring any loss. Because unless and until the options are exercised, the company does not incur a loss. If an option is lapsing in between, the company has never incurred a loss on those options lapse. So one correction which we genuinely made is this part. Now tell me, what is the correction? Loss to the company is number of options. This is wrong. It is not number of options granted, because sometimes there can be a lapse. If there is a lapse, to that extent the company has never incurred a loss. So I'll say number of options exercised. Only for those options exercised into the fair value or intrinsic value of options will give you what is a loss to a company. But unfortunate thing is, we will not know what is the number of options exercised until we reach this date. Until we reach that date, I do not have an idea of how many options are going to be exercised at all. Because I am trying to create the loss as a provision between the first 3 periods. But the number of options exercised will be after 31st March 2018. So until then, how will you create a loss to that period? So what we'll try to do is, we'll try to estimate the lapses. He'll give you an estimate saying that I am expecting 15 employees to lapse before the end of the vesting itself. Got it? So whenever such a thing is given, then we have to use the information. Sometimes they say that 2% of the options granted will lapse at the end of each year. So we can use that information as well. So there will be something which will be given in the question, which is indicating you what could be the lapses during this 3 years period. Got it? So if there is no adjustment given, then he is not expecting any lapse. Hypothetical situation, guys. You won't get such a situation. Let's see the accounting entries then. Simple accounting entries, guys. Date of grant. Date of grant is not even a transaction, guys. Okay. Your company is allotting shares, allotting the options, but the company is not receiving anything in return. So I cannot say that there is a transaction here. Transaction should involve a give and take. Not possible. What can I record? I am recording a loss to the company. When am I recording? Proportionately over the period of vesting. That means if I have granted the options on 1st April 2015, for 2015-16 also I have to record a loss. For 2016-17 also I have to record a loss. For 2017-18 also I have to record a loss. Such recording or losses is a provisional loss. When is the actual loss? When the option is vested. Until then, we are only trying to estimate the loss and creating it as a provision. And every provision should be created only on balance sheet date. So my accounting entry will start only with the balance sheet dates up to vesting. Up to the vesting period, every balance sheet date, 31st March 2016, 31st March 2017, 31st March 2018. Three entries, 3 years. The entry that we pass is employee compensation expense account debit to employee stock option outstanding. This is a nominal account and this is a personal account. It's an expense. Expense are always nominal. It's a provision. Such a provision which is maintained for an employee, I'll call it as a personal account. All nominal accounts should be transferred to P&L at the end of the year. So P&L account debit to employee compensation expense. Now I'll continue these two entries for three balance sheet dates. Once three balance sheet dates are over, that is 31st March is over, then what do we have to do? I have to pass exercise dates. Because there is an exercise period, that is 31st March 2018 to 31st March 2019, where the options vested can be exercised. Exercise of options. When the option is exercised, entry is, I am receiving cash to the extent of exercise price, bank account debit. This is for exercise price. Because each employee has to pay that 50 rupees first. Then I am saying another debit to whatever loss we have created. We have created the loss as a provision. Now I am utilizing the provision, debit the provision. Either for fair value or intrinsic value, whatever the case might be. What am I allotting him? I'm allotting him equity shares. So get equity share capital and they'll be allotted it as premium, then you get securities premium as well. Always put the premium as balancing figure, it will be easier. Now whatever entries I have given just now is for employee stock option plan. What if it was a stock appreciation right? If it was a stock appreciation right, then this provision name will change. Since these are options, I wrote it as employee stock option outstanding. They were stock appreciation rights. So I'll write it as stock appreciation right outstanding. That doesn't make any difference. Instead of writing this entry like this, I'll write SAR outstanding account. Can you give me the exercise option for cash settled scheme? What happens in SAR? The net amount is paid in cash. So whatever provision is there, I'll happily pay off in cash. Entry is SAR outstanding account debit to cash. Whatever loss you created, that is the amount of cash payment. That's it. Yes guys, now think about accounting treatment for lapse. What is the first type of a lapse? Where the vesting condition is not satisfied, such options might be lapsed. Now, do I have to record a separate accounting entry for that? What I'll say is not required. Let's say, first suppose I had 100 options. I had 100 options. Basically, each one had an exercise, intrinsic value or a fair value of 60 rupees. So, what is the total provision required? 100 options into 60 rupees, 6,000 rupees. Let's say I was providing it for 3 years. So how much I'll provide? Every year 2,000, 2,000 I'll provide. First year I provided 2,000. We came to the second year. 100 options, already 20 are out. Already 20 options have lapsed. So how many options are remaining? 80. What is the intrinsic value? Intrinsic value I said is 60 rupees. So 80 into 60 is only 4,800. How many years completed? 2 years. First year I made a provision on the entire 100, Now I have to make a provision only on 80 shares. Now think about it. 80 into 60, 4,800. Out of 3 years, already 2 years is over. So what do we write? 4,800 into 2 by 3 should be provided. How much should be provided? 1 third in the first year and 1 third in the second year. 4,800 into 1 by 3 is how much? 1,600. So 1,600 plus 1,600, basically the total what I have to provide is 3,200. How much did you provide in the first year? First year I did not know about the labs. So I provided entire 2,000. So second year I'll provide only balance 1,200. So what I'll try to do is I'll keep revising the provision. I'll keep revising the provision based on it. That is what we normally do for any provision. Provision for bad debt is put up at 5%. Very good. So does it mean that the bad debt should be 5%? Not necessary at all. Let's say bad debt was, provision for bad debt was 100 rupees. Opening provision was 100. Closing provision required was 150. Bad debt during the year was 40 rupees. Then what do we do? 100 rupees provision. Usme se 40 rupees should be nullified. Saying that that 40 rupees is the bad debt. So what is the balance provision? 60. What is the closing provision required? 150. How much provision will you create? 90. Same thing. Compare the opening provision with the closing provision. The difference should be the provision to be created in the current year. I will not record an entry separately for the lapse during the period of creating the provision. That means during the vesting period, if any lapse is there, I will not record any entry. No entry for lapse of option during vesting period. No entry means I'm not treating it. No, I am treating it. But what do we do? Adjust or adjusted against loss to be provided in the current year. But what is the second lapse? Second lapse is of those options which were vested but they were not exercised. When did you create the provision? From 1st April 2015 to 31st March 2018. For whatever options are vested, I am assuming them to be exercised. And I am creating a provision during this 3 years. But when did you know about the second lapse? At the end of 31st March 2019. That means, as on the day when I was creating the provision, I did not have any idea about that. These lapses which are going to happen at the end of 31st March 2019. That means, let's say there were totally 80 options which were vested, I create a provision on entire 80. But let's say only 75 are exercised. Then, for those 5 shares or 5 options which are unexercised, also I create a provision. Now, where is the provision stored? Employee stock option outstanding account. These options are lapsed now. So how do we record the entry? We'll have to reverse the entry. Whatever entry is there, just put it ulta. Employee stock option outstanding account debit credit to. Do not take it to employee compensation expense because it is a nominal account. When did you create this nominal account? Up to 31st March 2018, every year I create it. But when are you recording this current entry? It is a lapse at the end of the exercise period. As on that day, I don't have any employee compensation expense at all. It is a profit, but directly take it to general reserve. Do not impact the P&L in any way. Extraordinary non-trade item, guys. Though, yeah, it is a profit. But it's an extraordinary non-trade item, so I don't want to put it to P&L. I'll directly take it to general reserve. This is the entry for lapse of option, lapse of vested options, unexercised. lapse of vested options unexercised. We record this entry. So we have seen two lapses. One, if the vesting condition is not satisfied. Two, when the options are vested but the exercise period is completed and he did not pay the amount of exercise. So exercise price was not paid, even those people allot the share, they are called as lapse of options. So for the first type of a lapse where the vesting condition is not satisfied, I will not record any entry only. But for the second type of lapse, when the vested options are not exercised up to the end of the exercise period, I have already created a provision for such options as well. So such provision which is created should be reversed. So and I am crediting it to general reserve. Vesting conditions need not be so simple also. Vesting conditions will go to the extent of saying that if the net profit of the company reaches 14%, 16% I'll allot. Okay. So based on some or the other conditions, he'll be putting it. If my number of employees in the organization have increased beyond 1,000, then I'll allot options. My wish, whatever language I want, I'll put. Vesting condition is at the option of the company who is granting the options. So they'll have their own vesting conditions there. Obviously, which makes sense. Simple accounting entries, guys. The crux of the entire questions will be based on how do you create the amount of provision, how do you calculate the provision every year. Once you get the calculation of provision, same entry what you are recording all the time. Will there be a lapse of options in stock appreciation rights? Lapse of rights, can that happen? It can happen during the vesting period if the vesting condition is not satisfied. But it cannot happen at the end of the vesting period because there is no exercise in that. The company has to pay cash, they will pay cash. So let's see the first question. Question number one. ABC grants 1,000 employee stock options on 1/4/2008 at 40 rupees. So 1,000 is the number of options granted. 1/4/2008 is the grant date. 40 is the exercise price. Market price is 160. Vesting period is 2.5 years. Exercise period is 1 year. 300 unvested options lapsed on 1/5/2010 and 600 were exercised on 36/2011. 100 vested options lapsed at the end of the exercise period. Pass the journal entries with suitable narrations. When we have such a question, how do we start recording for it? Guys, the entire question is not about your recording entries, guys. Entries anyone will write. It is the amount that you prefix or, that is there at the entry. What is the amount of a provision to be created every year during the vesting period? Check. When was the option granted? Options was granted on 1/4/2008. Grant date 1/4/2008. Options granted. Thousand. Exercise price 40. Market price per share was 160. When I know the market price and the exercise price, I can calculate what is intrinsic value. Intrinsic value of option. Market price minus exercise price 120. Market price per share minus exercise price. And finally, vesting period being 2.5 years. Come on, guys. If the grant date is 1/4/2008, then when do I record my first entry? On the first balance sheet date after your date of grant. What is the first balance sheet date after your date of grant? This is very careful. Be very careful with this, guys. The first entry to be recorded on 31st March 09. Second entry, next balance sheet date, 31st March 2010. I don't need next balance sheet date because my vesting period is only 2.5 years. So I'll take this as 30th September 2010. Now, check. Always start with number of options expected to vest. Or you can call it as number of options outstanding also. Options expected to vest actually makes sense. First year, I have the entire 1000 options. Even on the second balance sheet date, I have 1000 options. But continue reading. In the third line, he says 300 unvested options lapsed on 1-5-2010. 1-5-2010 is the last 6 months period where 300 unvested options are lapsed. So the balance options expected to vest are only 700. What is the intrinsic value? Intrinsic value of option is 120. Multiply, you will get what is the total loss. Already seen the formula, loss to company is number of options expected to vest into intrinsic value or fair value. Here I have intrinsic value. 1,20,000, 1,20,000, and 84,000. How many years should I provide this loss over the vesting period? Vesting period is 2.5 years. Vesting period is 2.5 years. Yes guys, when you know the vesting period, now you need employee compensation expense. Come on. How do we calculate this employee compensation expense? Employee compensation expense. Let's split this into three parts now. Employee compensation expense on a cumulative basis minus less already provided in the previous year . This will give us a balance to be provided in the current year. That is what we want. That is the amount of provision to be recorded in the current year. Let's continue. Come on, first cumulative basis, how many years are over? 1 year is completed out of 2.5 years. So if my total employee compensation is 1,20,000, my cumulative is 1/2.5. Second year, 1,20,000 total loss. 2 years are over out of 2.5 years, 2/2.5. Last year, 84,000 loss into 2.5/2.5. 1/2.5 is 48,000. 2/2.5 is 96,000. Last one, same figure you get because numerator and denominator of 2.5 gets cancelled. First year, what is provided in the previous year? Nothing. It's the first year. So provision to be created is 48,000. Year 2, already provided in the previous year 48,000. Current year provision required is 96. So my provision to be provided in the current year is only 48. 48 provided in the first year, 48 provided in the second year. What is the total provision? 96,000. 96 already provided in the previous year. How much do you need? Only 84. That means I have a negative 12,000 rupees here. That means the provision was excess. So we'll write back the provision to the extent of those 12,000 on the date of vesting. These 300 options lapsed were on 30th in May 2010. That means giving the balance sheets on 31st March 2009 and 2010, I did not know that there was a lapse. Okay, the lapse identified only in the month of May. So we did not know the lapse was on the other two balance sheet dates. Record the entries now. Journal entries in the books of ABC Limited. Take down that and then record the entries. Journal entries in the books of ABC Limited. First date on 31st March 2009. 31st March 2009. Employee compensation expense. Account debit. To employee stock option, outstanding account. First year, how much amount? 48,000. 2 entries every year because this employee compensation expense should be transferred to P&L. The entries will be same on 31st March 2010. Same 2 entries. Record the entries, guys. Both the entries again. When we're doing 31st March 2010. My next entry date is 30th September 2010. I have a negative provision. So write off the provision. Employee stock option outstanding. Account debit to general reserve. Don't give it to employee compensation expense. Employee compensation expense is a nominal account which is closed every year. Finally, come to the exercise entry. $600 options were exercised on 36-2011. 100 unvested options, 100 vested options lapsed at the end of exercise period. How many options actually vested? 700. But on 36-2011, only 600 options were exercised. 36-2011. Come on. Let's go for the entry now. Exercise entry. Bank account debit. First, he will receive the exercise price. How many options? 600 options. Exercise price per option is 40 rupees, 24,000. Debit the provision. We are utilizing the provision. Employee stock options outstanding. ₹600 × 120 intrinsic value. 72,000. To equity share capital. Each share is 10 rupees, so 600, 6,000. Securities premium can be taken as a balancing figure. ₹90,000. This is my exercise entry. Instead of calling securities premium as a balancing figure, I can also say that the market price per share is 160. Face value is 10, then the premium is 150. 150 × 6,000 is 90,000. What is the end of the exercise period? When did the options vest? 30th September 2010. What is he saying? With a vested option, they have an exercise period of 1 year. That means I can exercise these options before 30th September 2011. But however, I did not. So on 30th September 2011, that is the end of the exercise period, 100 options which were vested were unexercised. Check what are the number of options vested? 700. How many options exercised? 600. That means 100 vested options are unexercised. Same entry I'll record. Employee compensation expense. Employee stock option outstanding account. How many options? 100 options. Each one I created a provision for 120. Credited to general reserve, 12,000. That is it for the accounting entries. Check once, how much employee stock option outstanding did you provide in the first year? 48. Second year, 48. 96. Third year, I debited it by 12. So 96 will become 84. Out of 84, on exercise, I utilized 72,000. How much balance left out? 12,000. The 12,000 is written off to general reserve. At the end of your 30th September 2011, you will observe that your employee stock option outstanding account will become 0.